250 years ago, Swiss clockmakers were using their skills with cogs and gears to build some of the first droids for the entertainment of the royal families of Europe. Back then, they were known as automata, and the most popular of all were mechanical singing birds. Since the 19th century, most automata have been made in the small Swiss town of Sainte-Croix. One of the oldest companies here, Frère Rocher, was founded by three brothers back in 1813. They supplied singing birds to Napoleon, a 19th century gadget geek. To celebrate the company's bicentenary, master craftsman Nicolas Cor used modern precision to create an original 21st century take on the brothers' designs.
Pas une seule pièce déjà identique, donc elles sont toutes différentes. C'est toujours un énorme plaisir, évidemment.
This diamond-encrusted bird box is made from over 1,200 unique components. It's powered by a mechanism that works like clockwork and costs an incredible 880,000 euros.
En termes de montage, de finition et tout, il y a plus de 300 heures.
For every automata, each tiny cog and chain must be made to measure. One man who knows a thing or two about keeping the cogs turning is stamping engineer Jean-Luc Robin.
Ça, c'est une étampe qui nous sert à fabriquer des roues de rocher.
La face, ça, c'est...
Once the stamp is loaded into the machine, a hydraulic press exerts 22.5 tons of force down on a steel disc, creating a cog less than 2 centimeters across.
Autant de pièces qu'il y a d'étampes sur les étagères. Chaque étampe sur une étagère a une propre forme. On fait des ronds, des pièces compliquées, des carrés, des trous, des pliages, plein de formes. On en fait, je sais pas là, des milliers.
But some parts are so complex, they need to be pressed one after another by up to 3 different stamps to create the tiny teeth, grooves and cams. The newly formed components and bird are passed on to artisan assemblyman Bertrand Gogely to build the intricate clockwork mechanism.
Avec beaucoup de choses différentes et que ça doit sortir un chant d'oiseau propre, net. Donc, c'est une passion.
Once he's built the mechanism, his next challenge is to make this bird sing. Miniature bellows breathe life into his creation. The mechanism drives a wheel that pumps a small bellows, which blow air through a tiny whistle. At the same time, the wheel also moves a piston in and out of the whistle, producing different notes. It may sound sweet, but unless he can make its wings move, this bird will end up a turkey.
Celui-là fait fonctionner l'oiseau.
Inside the bird is a tiny spring-loaded steel rod that moves the beak and wings.
Ce levier-là, c'est très important parce que ça appuie un autre levier ici qui fait basculer les ailes de l'oiseau, qui fait fonctionner l'oiseau. Donc on voit bien.
Once he's sure it can flap and spin, he fixes the 50-gram feathered friend to a lever to pop it up. But if it's not positioned perfectly, this bird ain't gonna fly. So a decorative brass template keeps it exactly aligned. The song and dance need to be synchronized. To solve this, another tiny lever moves the bird while simultaneously opening and closing a valve, connecting the bellows to the whistle.
Ici, celui-ci va pousser sous l'oiseau, là, ici. Et ici, ça appuie ici.
The mechanism is wound up and it's ready to go.
Et après, start.
After 300 hours and 20 artisans doing their bit, the bird finally goes into its own gilded nest. Et voilà! These mechanical marvels may have kick-started the robot revolution, but it's the human touch that makes them so endearing. Crafted today as they were originally, over 200 years ago. This is Cashgate and Partners in North London, just 15 kilometers from the Lifeguards Hyde Park Barracks. They've been making uniforms for the British Army for 72 years. Marlon Cashgate is one of five family members working for the business.
I can actually feel myself welling up a little bit when I watch Trooping of the Colour. I feel really, really proud about the whole thing.
Every uniform starts with 23 individual measurements, taken by Marlon's older brother, Russell.
I've known this young man for many years, and it's nice catching up. I love doing this. It's great.
The tunics for the lifeguards are made up of 43 separate pieces of cloth from Haynesworth's Yorkshire Woolen Mill. Whilst each tunic is unique, the colour is always the same. British Army approved lifeguard scarlet. The myth is that they're red so as not to show blood. The real reason is probably that 360 years ago, red dye, made from madder root, was cheap and easily available. Russell Cashgate's son, Nathan, leads a team of 10 cutters who mark up the sections by hand. It's a fine balance getting a neat fit where the soldier can still move comfortably on a horse.
We just chalk out each bit to the pattern for the individual's measurements because it's all bespoke.
The tightly woven fabric is so thick that normal scissors are too blunt to cut through it. So Beata Warcoal slices through it with an electrically powered, super sharp rotary cutter. But even though it's been cut to the lifeguard's measurements, they won't know if it fits until he tries it on. So the fabric is roughly stitched together with white basting thread. 9.5 hours of cutting and stitching later, it's time for the moment of truth. This is Russell's opportunity to fine-tune it so that it fits the lifeguard perfectly.
Right. I'm going to take that in a little bit. All right, it will be fine, so I'm going to shorten the collar.
Now, all that sewing has to be unpicked so the seams can be adjusted before everything is re-sewn all over again. When you're the centre of attention at the Queen's birthday parade, you need to make sure it's a perfect fit.
It's being reassembled now from their fitting to make sure they're getting the best fit.
But sewing machines create tight, unforgiving seams, and a well-fitting tunic needs to mould to the shape of the wearer. So a team of 12 skilled seamstresses called handfellers carefully stitch the panels together with 4 stitches in every centimetre of seam. In the past, these tunics had a secret second use, as bedding in the field. So a quilted wool and cotton lining is stitched to the inside. The colour of the cuffs and collars played a key role identifying different regiments in battle. The ones for the lifeguards are cut from dark royal blue velvet. The collar needs to stand up around the soldier's neck to protect it from rubbing, so a layer of stiffened linen, called buckram, is stitched to the back of the velvet. Now Marlon needs to attach it in exactly the right place, so it's symmetrical. A red mark on the inside of the collar shows Marlon exactly where it goes.
It must match. And it's tricky because it's velvet. I've actually just put the collar in. I'm looking at it and I'm pleased.
Finally, it's all sewn up. And 9 gold-plated buttons, stamped with the lion and crown from the royal crest, are stitched into place. This tunic is for the lowest rank of lifeguard, a trooper. But every rank needs to look the part. So before they leave the factory, every uniform is given a final check.
We're at the inspection stage of it, just checking everything's right. The buttons from the hooks should be spot on.
This one passes muster. Another tunic fit to be paraded in front of the Queen.